Hello, welcome to the Delta Conveyance Project Community Benefits Workshop. My name is Juliana Burkoff. I'm a facilitator and I work with Ag Innovations. For closed captioning, you should see a screen at the bottom of your screen, you should see Live Transcript CC. If you want closed captioning, click on that, that icon. I hope no one has technical trouble, but if you do, you can always dial into the Zoom meeting with your telephone. You won't see all of the presentations, next slide, but you will see, you will be able to hear all of the information. There's the telephone number. All of the presentation slides and all of the materials will be on the Department of Water Resources website. So for those of you who want to follow along, that's where to find them. This meeting will be recorded, as I said, and there'll also be a summary on the meeting site. I'm going to turn now to Reina Rodriguez. The meeting will be in English and Spanish. Reina will walk through for you how to participate in Spanish. Reina.
Muy buenas tardes a todos. Bienvenidos a la reunión. El día de hoy esta reunión será presentada de manera simultánea. Si usted necesita interpretación en español, favor de seleccionar el icono que parece un mundo abajo de su pantalla. Después de que seleccione el icono que parece un mundo, va a seleccionar español y después va a seleccionar poner el audio original en silencio o la opción que dice mute original audio. De esta manera usted va a poder escuchar la presentación solamente en español. Si usted está usando un celular o una tableta, sus opciones van a ser diferentes. Usted va a necesitar seleccionar los tres puntos que están en la pantalla, indicando more options o más opciones. Y de esta manera usted va a poder ver la opción de lenguaje. Después seleccionará español, seguido por silenciar el audio original. Y por último, va a poner listo para que de esta manera pueda participar en su totalidad en español. Y le invitamos a someter cualquier comentario también en español. Bienvenidos a la junta.
Thank you so much, Reina. So, again, closed captioning is at the bottom of your screen and you just click live transcript and that will give you the closed captioning. If you have any trouble, you can always dial into the meeting with the Zoom number that was given to you when you got that. And all the presentation slides are on the DWR website. And we're recording the whole meeting, so you'll be able to hear it in English and Spanish afterwards. So please remember to choose the Spanish icon if you want to hear everything translated into Spanish. If you only speak English, please choose English so you can choose the Spanish interpretation, so you can hear the Spanish interpretation as well as English. Great. So my name is Juliana Burkoff, and I work with Ag Innovations. I would like first to introduce several people who are attending the meeting. The Department of Water Resources and the public water agencies have staff people attending this meeting. They're here to hear your community benefits ideas. They will not be participating in any of the polls or asking questions. They'll be actively listening to your input. There are several people attending from the participating public water agencies. Ryan will spot each person as I introduce them so you know who's participating. Frances Brewster is from Valley Water. Jennifer Nevels is from the Metropolitan Water District. And Brent Walthall is from the Kern County Water Agency. Thanks so much. To begin, let us turn to Royce Fast, who will welcome you to the meeting. Royce Fast has served as a director for the Kern County Water Agency for 8 years and is entering his second year as president. During his tenure, Mr. Fast has played an important role through his involvement in a variety of agency activities associated with the State Water Project, the Delta Conveyance Project, and local groundwater management projects. Mr. Fast is a native of Bakersfield and a fourth generation farmer in the Rosedale area. Mr. Fast.
Thank you, Juliana. My name is Royce Fast. I am president of the Kern County Water Agency Board of Directors. I'd like to welcome you all tonight to this community benefit workshop. The Community Benefits Fund is an important part of the Delta Conveyance Project. And for it to work well, the Delta community work well for the Delta community, we need to put your ideas and input from you. I'm a fourth generation farmer, and I know there are many multi-generations farmers in the Delta too. It is an extremely important ag region, and I understand that. I know firsthand that no one understands the needs of the region that I farm in better than the people that live, farm, and work there. And I'm sure that is just as true for the Delta. Any community benefits fund should include projects and programs that reflect the needs of the local community. And you are the best people best able to define what those needs are. I appreciate that you have decided to participate this evening, and thank you for your time.
Thank you so much, Mr. Fast. So let me go to the meeting objectives, the agenda, and how to participate. So the objectives for this meeting are first to make sure that everybody understands what the Community Benefits Program is. We'll also give you a recap from the first two workshops. This is the third workshop, and there was also a tribal workshop. Finally, the important goal is for you to provide input and feedback on opportunities for economic development, including targeted hiring, local business utilization, and integrated infrastructure. The agenda is we've had welcome and introductions. We're going through the agenda and how to participate. Carrie Buckman will go through the Community Benefits Program overview and the recap. You'll have a presentation about economic development and integrated infrastructure. Then there'll be a brief presentation about community engagement, and then a general period of time for public input. Three ways for you to provide input tonight. The chat function is for you to ask questions. First, the chat function is not turned on at the moment, but we will turn on the chat function at the beginning of each presentation. If you have a brief clarifying question, go ahead and chat that question to me in the chat box. I will try to cue that question for the presenter to answer during their presentation. You can only send questions to me, Juliana Burkoff, but I will monitor the chat box for those questions. If the presenter does not have time to answer during the presentation, I will pass those questions to DWR and the Delta Conveyance Authority to answer during the public input portion of the agenda. If we don't get to your question tonight, Department of Water Resources and the Delta Conveyance Authority will try to address them on the DWR website. So providing input. So those are questions, providing input. First, we will use polls for you to, there'll be four polls and you'll be able to ask, answer questions about preferences during presentations. We use polls to gather some broad input on preferences. The poll will appear on your screen. Using your mouth, you'll choose your answer. I'll pause for a minute so you can see what those answers are and we can see them all together. Following all the presentations, there'll be a chance for you to provide input in the second way. The second way is to raise your hand and we'll unmute your microphone and ask you to provide comments for 2 minutes. Evidently on Zoom, there are two ways to raise hands. One is you'll see at the bottom of your screen, you'll see a button that says reactions. You click on that reactions icon and there'll be a choice to raise your hand. You click on that and your hand will go up. I'll see it. We'll call on you, give you 2 minutes, etc. The second way is to go to the participants icon at the bottom of your screen. You hover on your name and you will see more on the menu for the participants menu. Click more and it will give you a choice to raise your hand. So either of those two ways, and I'll remind you again when we get to that point, to raise your hand. We will invite you to unmute your microphone. You'll have 2 minutes to provide input. You'll see a timer on the screen and then we'll remute your microphone after that. We encourage you to use the third way also to send input, which is to go to the Department of Water Resources website. And on that, there is a community benefits program document comment form that you can fill out your ideas and your responses, or you can just send an email to that email address on your slide, deltaconveyancecbp@water.ca.gov. So I hope you'll take advantage of those ways to provide written, verbal input or through the polls. So the first poll, we're curious to know what county you live in. So if your staff don't participate in this, but the people who are participating, what counties do you live in? The choices are Alameda, Contra Costa, Sacramento, San Joaquin, Solano, Yolo, or other. I'll wait for a little bit until we see that at least, let's see, it's telling me 30% voted, 35. We'll wait till at least 50 of you have voted. Slowing down. Does anybody else let us know what county you live in? Okay, so it looks like about half of you are from Sacramento County. The next half of you are from, let's see, Sacramento, and then the next half of you are from other counties, and then from Solano, and then a mixture between the other ones. Thanks so much. So that's where people are represented coming from. So let's go to the next presentation. Carrie Buckman is the Environmental Program Manager, and she will go over what the Delta Conveyance Project is, the Community Benefits Program, and how the Community Benefits Program fits into the Delta Conveyance Project. Carrie.
Thanks, Juliana. I guess I wanted to start with just a big thank you for coming tonight. I know that you all have places to be and things to do that include, you know, dinner. And I really appreciate that you're spending this time with us. Thank you. So in the past meetings, and this is the third meeting out of three, we have talked about the Delta Conveyance Project and how the Community Benefits Program fits in. And we didn't want to go through the whole set of information again because we thought that might be repetitive for people who came, but we also didn't want to start with nothing in case people were only able to come tonight. So I'm doing a pretty quick overview, but if you're interested in more materials, the materials from our first two meetings are posted on our website, so there is more information available. So I wanted to start with the underlying fundamental reason that DWR is considering the Delta Conveyance Project. Our purpose is to modernize the aging State Water Project, or SWP, infrastructure in the Delta to restore and protect the reliability of SWP water deliveries in a cost-effective manner consistent with the state's water resilience portfolio. And we want to really work on maintaining reliability in the face of many challenges that we know are going to be coming for the State Water Project. And so our objectives reflect some of those. We want to look for a project that could help address sea level rise and climate change, minimize water supply disruption due to seismic risk, protect water supply reliability, and provide operational flexibility to improve aquatic conditions. So the Community Benefits Program is one part of three distinct but complementary processes. We're starting with our environmental planning as part of the California Environmental Quality Act, or CEQA. We're working to identify the effects of the project and consider ways to avoid or reduce the significant environmental impacts. And we understand that CEQA is pretty prescriptive, and the types of impacts that it focuses on may not cover all of the types of things that are felt by the communities that would be affected by this project. So in addition, we're considering this community benefits program, and the purpose would be to provide resources to direct benefits toward communities most impacted by implementation based on community collaboration. And additionally, we're looking at an ombudsman program, and that would be a clearinghouse single point of contact to streamline information, support, and claims. So if someone had a question about what was going on with the project or construction, they would have one place to call. I wanted to review the core commitments that DWR is making as part of this planning effort for the Community Benefits Program. If the Delta Conveyance Project were approved, the core commitments for Community Benefits Program would include that it is transparent, that we'll have an open process, that it is constructive, that we would participate in good faith with the community to create a positive legacy, that it is inclusive, that there is broad stakeholder participation to expand the capture of voices, that it is fair, that the benefits are related to the effects, and number five is really the most important that I wanted to emphasize tonight, is that it is unconditional, that community benefits are not dependent on support for the project. We understand that many people are going to continue to oppose the project, and talking to us about the potential for community benefits does not in any way mean that you support the project or do not oppose it. We understand that people will continue to oppose the project, and receiving these benefits is not conditional on support for the project. So this talks about the reasons that we're considering creating a community benefits program. So the purposes are to acknowledge that the direct project benefits focused on state water project reliability are not located inside the Delta, and acknowledge that if the project is approved, it could have potential adverse effects that Delta communities may endure through construction, and acknowledge that the limitations of traditional CEQA environmental mitigation may not be able to cover all of the types of effects that could be experienced by the project. There are two key components of the community benefits program. The first is the community benefits fund that we talked about at the last public meeting, where we talked about a proposed fund and potential ideas of what that fund the types of projects that that fund could support. And the second is implementation commitments, which will be the focus of tonight's meeting, which could include hiring targets, job training, education, local business utilization, and multi-purpose facilities. So before we really focus on those implementation commitments, I did just want to mention some of the key messages that we heard during the first and second workshops. From the people who came to the meeting, we heard that people do not like the Delta Conveyance Project, but are prepared to discuss the community benefit program. We also understand that people suggested some language changes to the concept, purpose, objectives, and funding categories of the community benefits program. And people made thoughtful and comprehensive suggestions about funding ideas to possibly include in a Delta fund. And so with that, Juliana, I'm going to pass this back to you to introduce Graham.
Great. Richard Markison has a question about community benefits agreements, and it looks to me like that question, Mr. Markison, relates to Graham Bradner's presentation, so I'll keep your question in the queue, but I think Mr. Bradner will answer it. Thanks. So let me turn now to Graham Bradner. Graham Bradner is the Interim Executive Director of the Delta Conveyance Design and Construction Authority. The DCA is the entity responsible for designing and constructing the project if it's permitted. The DCA partners with the Department of Water Resources on the Delta Conveyance. Graham will review the goals and the components of the proposed economic development and integrated benefits program. Graham, let me turn to you.
Great, thank you, Juliana, I appreciate that. So next slide, please, Ryan. Let's go ahead and get to the agenda. So today, we're going to review first an overview of potential facilities and locations associated with the Delta Conveyance Project. And then next, we'll talk about economic development concepts, really focused on defining economic development and then presenting a series of case studies. And then lastly, similarly, we'll go through integrated project benefits, or what are also referred to as leave-behinds, again, defining those and then going through a series of case studies. As Juliana mentioned in the intro, I want to just reiterate that in the current phase, the DCA provides engineering and conceptual design services to DWR as they pursue their environmental review. If this project were approved to move forward, we would engage a robust team dedicated to economic development, meeting procurement goals, and considering dual benefit construction considerations. My goal today at this very early stage is to provide some examples from industry to help guide this group to better understand how community benefit programs have been designed for other projects. So to begin with an overview of the project, first of all, this figure shows it on the right. There are actually three different variations of the project shown. And so to be clear, only one would potentially be selected. So the alignments shown are on the left side of the image, there would be the central alignment. On the right side of the image is the eastern alignment, there in purple. And then kind of following the eastern alignment, but then tearing off in the orange is what's referred to as the Bethany Reservoir alternative. So there's actually three different alternatives shown on this map. Not all would be built, potentially just one of three. So then we'll work through the facility types and locations. So starting on the north end, there would be intakes along the banks of the Sacramento River that would divert water into a series of tunnels and shafts that lead down to the south end of the Delta. So those tunnels and shafts would terminate. The main tunnel would terminate at a pumping plant, a new pumping plant. And so for Central and Eastern, you see those two converge at a location on the west side of Clifton Court Forebay. That would be the location of a new pumping plant for the Central and Eastern alternatives, whereas the new pumping plant for the Bethany Reservoir alternative is down there in orange, and it's on the at that point that's just on the south side of Clifton Court Forebay. And then all of the alternatives would use what's called the South Delta Connection facilities to then deliver the water to the existing State Water Project facilities. So in terms of economic development, we're going to focus on examples of in two specific key areas, first being targeted hiring programs, and the second being business participation programs. So the goal of economic development programs are to find ways to target portions of the massive investment required to deliver the Delta Conveyance program towards the regions most impacted by construction and populations or businesses that have historically been disadvantaged in public works contracting. So first, we'll start with targeted hiring programs. So just to make sure that we're all on the same page, and a quick note here, you're going to see, I'm sure, that many of these slides include quite a bit of text, which is probably more than would be preferred. This is intentional so that the presentations can live on as a reference for everybody. So we wanted to make sure that we captured everything on the slide. So there are a lot of words here, but just realize that is intentional and they're here for a reason. So first of all, the point of a targeted hiring program is to create opportunity to increase participation of socially or economically disadvantaged workers in a project or program. It's intended to help create long-lasting economic stability for targeted workers, extending to economic stimulus within their communities. We're going to go through a series of case studies in a minute. There are several commonalities, but I can say that most successful programs do include a partnership with existing job training programs, pre-apprenticeship, and other workforce development organizations that are all really focused on helping to create a qualified worker pipeline that can feed a project of this magnitude. Typically targeted workers would include those who are economically disadvantaged, veterans, single parents, individuals lacking a GED or high school diploma, folks with a criminal record, homeless, women and minorities. The target goals tend to vary between programs, and they're set by the various agencies or programs, but they would target achieving certain goals associated with the targeted workers listed on the top part of the slide. So now we're going to go through a series of case studies here. I think it's worth noting that in many cases, if not most cases, projects try and go above and beyond what may be the legal compliance in order to make meaningful change in the communities they work in. So again, going back to the fact that they're not all the same and they're typically set by each agency and each project to go above and beyond or deal with whatever regulatory requirements they might have. So first, to begin with, California High-Speed Rail. This is High-Speed Rail adopted a community benefit policy that includes a national targeted hiring initiative plan. This plan applies to all construction contracts of all sizes. One thing I'll point out with this one, and this is really something that virtually occurs in all of them, but I'll touch on it here with the first example, is there is what's called a third-party jobs coordinator whose responsibility is to network with those workforce development programs and pre-apprenticeship programs, and also with the contractors and the organization. That third-party coordinator networks to ensure that there is a pipeline of qualified workers so that those hiring goals can be feasibly met by the contractor and by the project. The next example is Los Angeles Metro, LA Metro, established a construction careers policy, is what they called it. One interesting element of the LA Metro program is they established a participation scorecard. And so this is an annually produced scorecard for each project that highlights the goals for minority, disadvantaged, female workforce, and then provides very transparent results with respect to each of those contracts. So essentially providing a metric or the ability to look and see how these different projects are doing with respect to meeting their participation goals relative to all those targeted hiring folks. Again, it mentions just that this particular one applies to contracts above $2.5 million, so slightly on the larger side. Another different example is with Seattle Public Works. In this case, the city council passed an ordinance to create a priority hire program. This program applies to public works construction contracts over $5 million. The way this program is laid out, it prioritizes hiring residents in the surrounding counties and economically distressed areas surrounding the projects, As part of that, they established what's called a priority hire implementation advisory committee, which really helps to work with the city council about the elements of their program, what works, what isn't work, how much engagement are they getting. The last example that we have here on targeted hiring programs is from the city of Portland. Again, this was a city council passed resolution, community benefit resolution. Their approach was to launch a pilot program for two specific projects, provided funding for outreach, recruitment, training, mentoring, technical assistance, all to really try and boost those workforce development programs and ensure that they were properly funded and heading in the right direction to support those projects. Oversight of this program is through what's called a labor management community committee that's intended to be representative of all the stakeholders that would be engaged in the program. The city council is using that pilot program to refine the plans for future projects. So they're taking a stepwise approach, initiating it with pilot programs, and then thinking about how to broaden it more broadly within the community.
So before we go to your input on targeted hiring, Mr. Bradner, is you at the moment, are you imagining that there'll be any sort of limitation on the kinds of construction workers who would be in this targeting hiring? Would it only be union workers, only women, only whatever? Or is it just you generally gave those examples as some ideas?
These are all just ideas. There's no limits being placed. These are just ideas about other programs that have been set up and how they've implemented.
Excellent. Thanks so much. And then are there specific small business targets in these targeted hiring programs, or is that something that you would target under the business utilization program?
Again, each project is unique, and so it's really too early to say at this point, but the point is there's not a one-size-fits-all solution. There's a lot of variability in the industry, and I think that's what the case studies are intended to show.
Thanks so much. So at the moment, it'd be helpful to have input from people on those kinds of things, and as you put out these programs and these policies, any targeted hiring program that was developed would of course comply with state law and any other kinds of laws about targeted hiring.
Absolutely.
Okay, great. So great, we want to hear from people now on your input on the targeted hiring program. Is this a good idea, not a good idea? So we're going to put up a poll and we want to know what your input is on the targeted hiring ideas for this part of the economic development. So the first one is the targeted hiring program sounds great, just what we need. The targeted hiring program is a good idea, but it needs to be adapted to the Delta. No, targeting hiring is not for us. I don't know, or maybe I don't have an opinion, maybe I don't understand, or maybe it's just I need more time to think about it. So let us know what you think about this targeted hiring idea. I'll wait a couple minutes to see if we can get more input from people. So again, the targeted hiring program sounds great, just what we need. The targeted hiring program is a good idea, but needs to be adapted. No, targeted hiring is not for us. I don't know or don't have an opinion. Maybe I don't understand. So choose one of those and let us know what you think. Okay, I'm not seeing that any more of you have an opinion on the targeted hiring. So if you don't have any more ideas about the targeted hiring program, we'll go to the next question. So Graham, let me turn it back to you on the next program implement.
Great. Thank you. So now we're going to talk about business participation programs. We'll take a similar format, first starting out with ensuring we're all talking about the same thing. So what is a targeted business program? They're intended to combat the effects of past discrimination and increase the participation of various disadvantaged businesses in public contracting, provide guidance, mandate that percentages of all services, goods, and materials are contracted to targeted business. They typically provide or allow for consideration of location, if that would provide a project benefit. That really helps to focus on local small businesses within the project area. And then they're intended to help create sustainable businesses and overall economic stimulus. And just as a point of reference, close to 50% of all the Californians are employed by small businesses. So obviously it's very important to the economic stability of the state. So typical targeted businesses would include what are called small business, micro business, disabled veteran-owned businesses, women-owned, minority-owned, as well as local small businesses. Similar to targeted hiring, the goals tend to vary and are set by the different agencies and programs specific to each project or program. So we'll go through a few case studies here now, focusing on business participation. Again, starting with high-speed rail. In this case, high-speed rail's program has to comply with both state and federal requirements because they do, depending on the source of funding, in which case high-speed rail receives both. Another interesting item with high-speed rail, they have a small business manager within the high-speed rail authority that oversees the program, similar sort of to the third-party jobs coordinator that just tries to network and ensure that there is a nice pipeline of small businesses who are able to participate in the program and help the contractors meet those goals. There's also a business advisory council that was formed, and this council is intended to provide input on the program when just putting those requirements on the contractor are proving to be insufficient. A next example here, City of Portland. So in this case, the City Council approved a policy that focuses on increasing minority-owned, women-owned, and what are called emerging small businesses and utilization of those in city contracting. An interesting thing about this program is that they actually utilize a procurement process that doesn't rely on low bid, at least not low bid as the primary factor. So this allows for other factors in consideration that would be the small business status and their ability to perform on the project in addition to potential bid prices. Created a city managed support service that helps to feed and support these small businesses as they try and service the city. Another example is LA Metro. In this case, LA Metro created what's called the Small Business Prime Program, which is specifically intended to promote small businesses to bid and win as prime contractors. So they begin to rise up the ranks and can work with other emerging small businesses as their own subcontractors. They are allowed to have set aside small business contracts of up to $5 million. So those would be specifically targeted for and limited only to Metro certified small businesses. Those categories do include everything. There's a whole list of different programs included in the Small Business Prime Program, including architecture and engineering, technical services, not just construction. Metro Connect is a LA Metro developed a tool and resource package called Metro Connect, which is an online interface that provides access and transparency about the procurement processes and all the small business programs within LA Metro, really providing all those tools and resources, again, to try and help support those Metro certified small businesses as they seek to participate in the SB Prime program.
Okay, so somebody asked earlier about business participation programs and if there was any that were specifically for small businesses. So Mr. Bradner, this sounds like the area where you would specifically want to be working with small businesses.
Right, all the targeted businesses that we listed back on the previous slides would include small businesses, emerging small businesses, disadvantaged, veteran-owned, women-owned, minority-owned. There's a whole host of businesses that would be included in this type of approach.
Got it. And so this approach is different than the targeted employment. It's to work with kinds of businesses. So I think those are the questions that people asked. So what we want to know now is, the first one was asking about targeted hiring. This one is looking at potential business participation. So we want to know now what your input is on potential business participation. So this will be a great economic benefit for the Delta. It's a good idea, but it needs to be tailored to the Delta have much effect. It's not a good idea for us. It's not worth the energy and resources to develop. Or the last choice is don't really know or don't have an opinion. This is something you maybe need more information about or just need some more time to think about. So we want to know from those of you who are not working for DWR or the participating water agencies, we really want to hear from people, as many of you as possible. Is this a good idea, not a good idea, or something that's okay but needs to be tailored? So let's wait to hear from more of you. Okay, I'm not seeing anybody else adding their ideas. Going, gone. So It looks like about 14% of you said that it was a good idea. 55% of you said that it needs to be tailored to the Delta. None of you said that it wasn't worth the energy. And 32% of you, 7 of you said, you need time to think about it, need some more information or a bit of time to think about it more. Thanks so much. So let's go to the next program.
Thank you very much. So now we're going to shift gears to what we're referring to as integrated project benefits. Hang on, I've got a poll. There we go. Integrated project benefits, also referred to as leave behind. So this is now we're stepping away from the economic development side of things, and we're now going to look at some design related elements. So first, to again define what we're talking about here, there's two types of integrated benefits that we're going to be discussing. The first would be site development that integrates a public benefit within the functional requirements of the project. So examples could include, for instance, take developing a ball field adjacent to one of the maintenance or reception shafts. This is post-construction, so after the area's already been all restored and now there's some open space there that would be available. So that's an idea that you know could be considered. Another similar idea would be to create public walking paths or something like that around the various facilities of the project. A different type of example, or the second type, would be utility development that creates a permanent utility benefit to the community. Examples of this would include adding a bike path, for instance, along one of the haul roads developed for the project, or extending high-speed internet service along some of the corridors near to the nearby communities, because there will be a lot of fiber optics required would be for the project. And so extending something like that to the nearby communities. So this is a case study. This is the Willamette River Water Treatment Plant in Oregon. This project included a large meeting space that was available to the public for community meetings. There was also a lot of landscaping, including a public park featuring cascading water features and pedestrian trails, and then educational kiosks and picnic tables were integrated into the building design to create interest and encourage folks to use the park. So now I'm just going to go through a couple of examples, but I want to note that these examples are from all the proposed potential tunnel routes. So you remember I showed there were 3 potential routes, only one would potentially be selected. So some of these may not be relevant depending on which corridor would be ultimately favored by the EIR process, but I'll try and point those out if they are specific that way. So running through some examples, for instance, local or regional community art programs, 4-H club experimental plots would be an idea. There'd be various opportunities for gardens, playgrounds, soccer fields, other athletic facilities. For instance, a Delta educational facility might be another idea. Walking trails, natural habitat areas or upland foraging habitat, river overlooks and educational kiosks would all be examples of integrated site benefits. And so now looking at potential utility and logistical benefits. So remember there were 2 that I talked about when we started introducing the subject. So now we're talking more utilities and logistics. So one example could be there an existing or a project related access road could, for instance, be turned into a Highway 160 bypass around the community of Hood, if that was viewed as a benefit by the community. There's, as everyone probably knows, there's a lot of congestion issues down on Byron Highway in the Mountain House area. There would potentially be new interchanges, road improvements, a whole host of different modifications down there as part of the project, and those could be integrated into the future plans for the roads and to manage congestion down in the area. I mentioned already there would potentially be a lot of fiber optic needed for the project. And so there could be turnouts for providing high-speed internet throughout various points within the Delta. There's also a lot of electrical power requirements that would potentially be needed. And those have to be brought in from the various sources. And so it could be that local drops could be provided for power that could upgrade the power service to various communities along the project alignment. And then also access roads. As I mentioned, there are various access roads. And so those could be expanded to include bike lanes, other types of recreational activities. So building further on that, there's certainly a need for various emergency response facilities associated with a program of this size. And those could be coordinated with the local emergency response facilities already in place and provide lasting benefit there. Also shared emergency response helicopter pad usage. This is particularly relevant at the south end of the project down by Clifton Court Forebay. Could also be that the park and rides or electric bus infrastructure or electric charging infrastructure built as part of the program could then be further used beyond that for all sorts of local uses. And then specific to the central alternative only, the central corridor, there would be a need to expand Highway 12, including the bridge over Potato Slough to get over to Bolden. And that certainly could provide long-lasting benefits to those who travel on Highway 12.
So there's these ideas about co-siting community project facilities and coming up with these integrated ideas. So do you support this idea of having community needs and project facilities, these leave behinds, these as they're the Delta Conveyance Authority is doing construction, coming up with things that provide benefits to the community at the same time? Good idea, not good idea. So we have 11 people responding so far. So yes, no, or don't know yet. Just wait a little bit longer and make sure everybody has a chance to think about this question. Okay, so it looks like everybody's voted who's going to vote. So about 16 of you said, yes, it's a good idea. And about one of you said it's not a good idea. And many of you said, don't know or don't have an opinion yet. Thanks for participating. So I'm going to turn now to information about the project engagement coming forward. I just have a couple of questions to ask either Carrie Buckman or Mr. Bradner. Carrie or Mr. Bradner, I'm not sure who should answer this. The information about the targeted hiring, local business, integrated infrastructure, people had several questions about that. Carrie, I think this is a question for you. If the project isn't permitted, would any of these targeted hiring, business utilization, infrastructure projects go forward?
So the community benefits program is a part of the Delta Conveyance project. So if the Delta Conveyance project does not move forward, then the community benefits program, including the fund and the targeted hiring and the implementation commitments, none of that would move forward either.
Okay. And these different projects and programs, these leave behind integrated infrastructure, would they be any danger where you would be locating them? Would they be in any danger of flooding if the levees failed? Can you know that now?
I think that's a Graham question.
Okay.
You know, I don't think it's possible to answer right now, Juliana, just because there's so little known. We don't even know which alternative we're talking about. And so certainly the considerations of flood risk would be a key factor in future design of something like that. So I don't think they would just be left to the, you know, to nature to sort out, but it's probably too early to say at this point.
Great. And in several of the examples, I think maybe the ones from Oregon or I can't remember, there's the discussion about the labor management committees and the union participation. Is there any, do you have a opinion at the moment, or are you still searching how this targeted hiring or local business utilization would work with unions, or is that up in the air at the moment?
I think that's all up in the air at the moment.
Is that the kind of thing you want input on, or it's too early?
I would not want to stop input, but I think it's too early. We at this very early stage, I think it's too early to say. I don't have an opinion.
Okay, great. All right. So let me then. So we've got some information from you on from the public on targeted hiring, local business utilization, integrated infrastructure. Let me turn to our next steps on community engagement. As several of you know, I've facilitated these now three meetings, as well as the tribal meeting, for the Department of Water Resources to work on community engagement. We don't want this, of course, to be the last thing we do. So moving forward, we'll work from best practices. The best practices that we have are first to reach out to grassroots and interest groups that don't always have a voice or can participate. That's really important. We also want to make sure that people know that their input doesn't depend on supporting the Delta Conveyance Project. We want to make sure that people have the information so that they can develop their input in the proposals based on the best available information. We want to have an open and collaborative process so that really broad community participation can occur. We want to make sure that all the engagement is transparent so that we have meetings in public, we share information, we record all the information so that people, even if they can't attend one of these meetings, can participate by online. We want to build on the plans and strategies that you've already developed. There's a lot that's already been developed in the Delta. We don't want to make you do your homework again. We want to build on that. We want to make sure going forward that we identify existing or help create new partners to represent the community interests. We want to make sure that the benefits that you develop are fair and proportional to the project impacts. And if the program is developed, we want to make sure that you can provide clear oversight and monitoring to ensure that sponsors and recipients are meeting their responsibilities. So those are the best practices for community engagement. So the framework that you've been providing input on will go into the EIR. At some point, the framework would need to be turned into a program. To develop a program, you would want to define the groups or the groups that would participate. So there might be a Delta Fund development group, there might be an integrated infrastructure group. We would want to identify what are the steps to recruit people to participate in those groups. We would want to form groups. We would want to figure out how those groups would make decisions, how they would make recommendations, and to whom they would make recommendations. And then you'd want to capture that in some sort of organizational documents. I typically call those charters. But what the process is, what the values are, how you would measure success, what the timelines are. So those would be the steps to turn the framework into a program. So what we're proposing as future actions is the first thing, probably in the fall, is to provide some tools to the community with in-depth information about how other community benefits programs or agreements have been developed. So maybe we would have a workshop. We're thinking we would invite people from those case studies that Mr. Bradner reviewed to talk about how they developed their program, what worked, what didn't work. Maybe would provide some one-pagers or some case studies or some overviews, some informational resources for you all to review. Maybe another step might be to interview Delta residents about their preferences for community engagement and program development. How do you want to move to the next steps on a community benefits program? So that's what we're proposing as the next steps for community engagement on the community benefits program. So I hope you can provide some input on that. I want to turn now to a chance for you all to provide some public input. We have at least an hour, which is brilliant, for you to provide input. So a reminder for you to raise your hands. You either go to the bottom of your screen, you see a place where it says participants, you click on participants, the participant screen opens up, you click on your name and you raise your hand. I see one person at least has done that. Or in some other versions of Zoom, you go to reactions, you click on reactions, it gives you a choice in the menu to raise your hand. So I'll call on people to provide input. I'll start the timer, and then we'll, if there's any questions that we haven't answered yet, please send those to me in the chat. Otherwise, I'll just call on people to provide public input. So Carol de Sacampos, are you the next person in the queue? We'll ask you to unmute yourself.
Thank you.
Great.
Okay. I had several questions, some of which I asked in the chat as we went along. I understand the desire for the project. I don't want to say that I'm against a project because I understand everybody needs water. It was mentioned that this project would address the adverse effects of the construction, you know, adverse effects to the Delta of the construction of this project. What about addressing the adverse effects after the construction of the project. In other words, if after the construction of the project, Delta Water is worsened, or levees are neglected and fail, or, I mean, is this being considered as a factor? Are there adverse effects to the Delta because of this project? That's my question. That's one question.
Let me pause for a second and we'll pause the timer. So Carrie, okay. I wonder if this is the moment when you can clarify the difference between the community benefits program and what environmental mitigation, typical mitigation would do.
Sure. So as part of the environmental analysis process, we are looking at the potential environmental impacts associated with both construction and long-term operations and maintenance of a project. So we're looking at both the environmental effects, including things like water quality of building the project and operating. And if we do find significant adverse effects, we will include measures to avoid or reduce those effects. But I also wanted to mention that some of the things that you mentioned that might be things that would be constructed in the long term to benefit the Delta, like levee improvements or water quality, both were discussed at length as part of the prior meeting for the potential project ideas for a Delta fund. So those are definitely things that we would consider. Those potential projects would provide benefits that could live on throughout the implementation of the project.
Thanks so much. Mr. Bradner, anything to add or?
No, I think Carrie got it just right.
Okay, so let me go back to you, Carol. You said you had another question.
It was about the businesses related to the Delta, wondering whether or not levee construction might be, a levee maintenance might be one of those businesses.
Got it. So when the community benefits fund starts funding projects, levees be part of that community benefits employment?
So potentially, if there were to be a project, there would be some levee improvement elements that are included in the current concept designs. And so absolutely, if there are local qualified small businesses, and this is exactly what we're talking about, that there would be potentially a need to ensure that there is a good pipeline of local resources available. They would, in that situation, they would be completely competitive and able to pursue opportunities just like that. So Carol, I think the answer would be yes, that there would be levy projects included in a project like this, and local businesses would then be a priority under a program like this.
Thank you so much. Mr. Finley, you have your hand up. Do you want to unmute and we'll call on you next?
Thanks. Can you hear me? Thank you, Juliana.
Sure.
I am having a hard time connecting our discussion at the last workshop with the discussion we're having here. And the reason being is it seems to me the targeted hiring program, integrated infrastructure, local business participation ought to all be a given with this project. I don't see that these are in any way above and beyond anything which would otherwise be expected of a project of this magnitude. At the last meeting, we talked about community benefits as above and beyond, and a number of items in 8 different categories that brought out a whole range of thoughts and ideas about what would be considered community benefits. When it comes to targeted hiring, when it comes to utilizing local business, when it comes to integrating infrastructure in the existing facilities, that in my mind is a given. That shouldn't be an above and beyond. I would like to understand why these are not part of the project and what happened to everything we talked about in the last meeting.
Great. So, Carrie or Graham, do you want to talk about how these are, in what sense are these above and beyond for a community benefits program, and in what sense are they just what's required?
Sure. So I'll take that. So we talked about a couple of different things, and Mr. Finley, I mean, I agree with you that you would expect there to be a need for something like this. This is potentially a massive infrastructure project, and it's going to need a qualified workforce and local businesses to support it. But it's intended to not only sort of provide for the project, and then after the project's done, it's over, it's to create long-lasting economic benefits to the region and targeting the programs to do so, to build those types of programs and to build that type of development so that it lives well beyond the construction phase of this project. Regarding the integrated design benefits, some of those examples I gave were unrelated to the actual design of the project features. So if we're talking about the design of an intake or the design of a tunnel shaft, providing some regional or local benefit by providing extra power drops for local communities who need a more reliable source of power, or creating fiber optic turnouts to provide high-speed internet to the local communities would not be required for the project. But these are examples of things that could be added to above and beyond examples. But they're not required as part of the project necessarily, but they would be great things to do for the people who are living and dealing with this project during construction.
Mr. Finley, and to answer your other question, we've taken notes on all those project ideas that people had from the last meeting. We've added that to the list of ideas that came from the tribal workshop or from the interviews. And there's a really, really long list of ideas at the moment of things that are community benefits program could fund if it's permitted. So that will go into the EIR framework, into the framework document. So did you want to add anything, Carrie?
I think Graham covered it well, thanks.
Okay. Richard Markison, I think you're next in the queue.
Hi, the fact that you characterize this as a discussion about community benefits agreements, which have largely been used by both the state and the local building and construction trades council as being roughly equivalent to a project labor agreement. And the fact that Mr. Bradner mentioned the use of a labor management coordinating or cooperation committee as supervising the community benefits agreement, the LMCCs are historically union focused between signatory contractors and workforce development. Can you clarify, has the administration concluded that the construction work that will be to whatever degree will be associated with this will be subject to a project labor agreement? Will this be union only, or will there be opportunities for non-signatory contractors utilizing their own workforce and their own apprenticeship programs to compete for and hopefully successfully be employed on the construction that is associated with these with this program? Thank you.
I can start. I mean, that did seem sort of directed to DWR, so I can okay. I can provide some context. So at this point, we're really still in the early phases of this. You know, our goal is that we want to reach out to the community and collect information from the community about what could be beneficial. We do not have a plan that really lays out how we would specifically accomplish the types of benefits that the community is asking for, including specifics about project labor agreements or union agreements. We're really still in the information collection phase at this point.
And so I would add, Carrie, to that, just in terms of the examples, I realized that those were a variety of conditions, and some of those may have used community benefit agreements, some of may have used PLAs, there's all sorts of different arrangements. Some were established by resolution, by city ordinance. So some of those are city policies. So there's just a range of conditions out there that have been employed, and the intention of those case studies was just to demonstrate this is just some other examples of what other programs have done. It wasn't to say that there's any sort of decision or anything like that that's been made.
Mr. Markison, did you have another follow-up question? Does that make sense?
No, thank you for clarifying.
Great. Okay, other questions about either the community benefits program in general, or about these this part of the economic development and implementation commitments part, or the next steps on public engagement? Carol, did you have another question? Let me call on you again.
Thank you. One more question. Is this conveyance project specifically to carry water south and have no connection whatsoever with improving or restoring the Delta water quality?
Carrie, so what's the goal of the water project and what will it do for Delta Water?
So the purpose of this project, you know, DWR is the owner and operator of the State Water Project. And so the purpose of this project for us is to work on restoring and protecting the reliability of the State Water Project supplies. And that the State Water Project supplies water to the Central Valley, parts of the Bay Area, parts of the Central Coast, and Southern California. Part of the idea of what we're talking about with the community benefits program is the potential for looking at other things that we can include within the Delta. So that is one of the things that's come up a lot during these community meetings, is looking at potential ideas related to water quality and other specifics within the Delta.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Other questions about the community benefits program or particularly about these economic development and implementation commitments, since we haven't had a chance for you to have any input on these so far. So let me ask some specific questions because the polls asked for some very general input. The economic, the targeted hiring programs, when I conducted some interviews with you all, you had lots of ideas about what kinds of jobs were needed in the Delta. And do the targeted hiring programs, do these make sense for you in the Delta? Are these the kind of targeted hiring programs that you want in the Delta? Is there a way to improve them so that these jobs that that will happen as the project is constructed help you with economic development and job training and economic development? What are your ideas about how these job training programs help you all in the Delta? If there's any specific input, because the input was like, yeah, maybe it's okay, maybe it's not, we need some more information. So this might be a chance for you to talk a little bit more and to ask some questions of Graham about how to make these targeted hiring programs really work for you in the Delta. Is there anybody in the participation group who's from one of these, an economic development group or works on economic development in any of the counties? Okay. How about for these integrated leave behinds? The idea that if the project is constructed, if it's permitted and constructed at places where there's a intake or a tunnel or a shaft or some kind of a facility, you could do something there with that land at the same place. Is there anything there that makes sense for you all? Let's see, Mr. Wallace, you had your hand up.
Yeah, thanks, Juliana. As far as the leave behinds go, I think everyone agrees that the Delta suffers from a lack of good internet service. And that was one of the very first things that came up a year and a half ago when this whole process sort of started. But the other thing that's always been part of this project and part of stakeholder input has been reducing footprints. And so leaving behind sports fields, bike paths, anything that creates a bigger footprint, I'm thinking that sort of goes against what we've talked about off and on here for the last few years. So I'd like to see that sort of considered very carefully. And because there's so many different needs throughout the Delta, that is regionally in the Delta, something that works in the North Delta might not work in the South part of the Delta, the Central part of the Delta, and vice versa. So I think there sort of needs to be this segregation of leave behind based on where you are in the Delta, which of course is exactly what you're trying to do with community benefits, as soon as you figure out who's going to have input into that process. So my takeaway from this is keep the footprints to a minimum. Don't make them any bigger than they already are. Thanks.
Harry or Mr. Bradner? Harry or Graham?
I appreciate the comment. It's a good comment, and Mr. Wallace is right. I think we've worked very hard to minimize footprints from an engineering side. And I think now is the time to take community input. And I appreciate the comment.
Carol asked, restoring natural habitats, can that be leave behind? Absolutely. There was the first two meetings talked about the categories of community benefits for the community benefit fund. And one of those categories was habitat conservation or water quality. There's also a category of recreation. And so there's a very long list of potential funding ideas, some very general, some very specific about things that you could do to restore natural habitat that maybe could be funded by the community benefits fund. So, which would be different than the kinds of, well, I guess, Ms. Graham, you could have, should there be a natural habitat?
Sorry, I couldn't hear the question all that well. Yeah, there you go. Go ahead. What was it again?
So, could you have a habitat conservation leave behind as part of the implementation commitments and the leave behinds?
Well, there are, I don't know if I would call it quite that. And I think probably Carrie might be the better person to answer this.
Yeah, I will say, I think that the habitat restoration, so again, as part of the environmental process under CEQA, we will be analyzing potential effects and identifying mitigation. So there will be habitat restoration actions as part of the mitigation measures that are required as part of the environmental impact report. But in addition to that, there is the potential for habitat restoration in addition to what's required. One example that we have been thinking about is that as we look at facilities, the DCA has laid out facility siting information and the area needed for construction is larger than the permanent long-term footprint. And we've been looking at what to do with those areas. And so we think that sort of the base condition is to try to return them to some type of agricultural use, understanding that it would be most likely more limited in terms of the types of things that could be grown than what's grown now. But another option would be some type of food production for area terrestrial bird species. There are other options that would be potentially included as part of the community benefits program. So I think that's a long way of saying, I think that primarily habitat restoration would be considered part of the fund and not part of the leave behind, but there are parts that overlap a little bit.
I'd like to go back to that long list of potential implementation commitments and ask if there's other ideas. There was a long list, Ryan, several slides back about possible different kinds of implementation commitments. I wonder if you can go back to the leave behind slides and ask if there's other kinds of ideas that people have. Great. So some of these ideas for integrated site beneficial uses, you saw the map at the very beginning of Graham's presentation. So do people have other ideas like these that would make sense as the DCA is constructing the area, designing the areas, would make sense to leave behind?
I have some ideas.
Great.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Raise my hand.
Yes, yeah, thank you. That works. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Matt Conover. I'm with John McCormick Company. We're on Twin Cities Road and corner across the road from where the entry shaft is supposed to be built, and a square mile of four bay and two overpasses over I-5, 50 to 150 trucks per day on Twin Cities Road, and two more rail sidings on the other side of I-5 that are going to take up another several hundred acres over there for the construction and the stacking of dredge spoils that are pulled out of the tunnel and stacked. We'll have dikes around those to prevent erosion into the waterways. But the main drainage of this whole reclamation district of 5,000 acres drops off to the south, and we're at the foot of this 5,000 acres. It's supposed to be pumped over the water coming off of there will get pumped over the slough. McCormick Williamson tract is across from us. That's owned by the Nature Conservancy, and DWR is co-owned that now, and they've had their own levee breaks over there. They've been buying up land for habitat upriver on the Cosumnes, and they've told the Delta Stewardship Council in public meetings that they thought were kind of private that their intent was to break down our levees and flood all the way north to Sacramento, where we see big south-facing levees, setback levees, built by that Bradley Kavanaugh golf course by Freeport and the Delta Shores Mall across the freeway. And they've said, after we've confronted them with that, that they're going to delay that. Apparently, they're delaying it because of all this construction going on. DWR has got to get their project in for LA Metro to get their water. Still talking about draining off a hell of a lot of water out of the Sacramento River and all the farms that we've got, other people have up and down the river. This community benefits isn't addressing that at all. All the community's economic impacts have to be addressed before this thing gets approved. You're going to have to close down Twin Cities Road for that kind of traffic. That's going to prevent us from getting in and out of our property. And we think there's buy-offs going on programmatically already that you already have visualized, like the Great Delta Trail. It's supposed to be legalized in state code already. But I've been to those meetings before a couple years ago. They were not being straightforward and honest about the hidden agendas of having all the routes already planned. When I said, you're not going to be able to run a bike trail down 160 on the levee without tearing out people's arbors and trellis anchors without it, for your rights of way and for the construction, you must have some alternative routes in mind. When I went and talked to the county planner, they did have alternative routes in mind, coming down Franklin Boulevard and down our levee, past the Nature Conservancy area that's built out by I-5, purchased and converted. Got good ecological justifications, but the connectors from there over to Main River and our railroad levee right here on the west edge of our property on Lost Slough and Snodgrass Slough are potentially rails to trails federal grant money that might be invoked as part of this and run their trail. Last I heard, they had some Parkway out in Yolo County, south of Sacramento and Westport. I can't figure out where that's supposed to connect to. Somehow they're probably going to get it back over to the levee that comes down out of Beach Lake by Cliffs Marina at Freeport and run along here. We have huge problems with public access right now. We don't want to be drawing a lot more people in here. We're talking about 15 years of impacts on all the ag operations in this area, Pearson District over to the river, as well as similar projects going on elsewhere. There's no community here. I don't see how there's going to be a community benefit to this other than bringing in more bike trails. And that's part of the problem we've got right now. And I'm going to start getting flustered if I try to talk anymore at this moment.
I just want to check in. So it sounds like you need more information. It sounds like you're worried about the transparency of what you've heard so far. And it also sounds like there's too many plans, too many agencies, too many things going on. So it's hard for you to keep track of what's happening and what. So do you have a question that you want to ask Carrie or Graham at the moment, or are you just expressing your frustration with all the planning and all the, it's hard for you to keep track of what's going on?
You summarized that very well. Thank you. It's a frustration of lots of projects that build up and then subside for a while. Yeah. And then we burn out on trying to participate, but they keep going because they're paid, but we've got to run our farms. We're right in the heavy season here for cherries now, and we'll be getting into pears and grapes soon.
Yeah,
and most of the farmers are so tired of all this, fighting this for 15 years now. They're, even the other people are frustrated too, but it's not the time to give up.
Right.
I'm really talking about larger things than just leaving some biscuits for communities like libraries or school programs or bikeways. We don't need more bikeways down here.
Okay, so the community benefits is not going to be enough for you, and it doesn't sound like you have enough ways to figure out what's happening with the Delta Conveyance project itself, and you need updates.
Well, there's lots of info out there, but we need dams on the Cosumnes to address flooding that's supposed to get more extreme with the more extreme droughts alternating in a more extreme cyclical pattern is going to be closer and closer together.
Right. So, Carrie, this might be a place where you can address so the multiple levels of programs in the Delta and what the Delta Conveyance Project is for compared to all the other multiple programs. Thanks so much for your comments. Carrie, let me turn to you and just clarify again what the Delta Conveyance Project is for versus all the other jillions of programs in the Delta.
So the focus of the Delta Conveyance Project is to provide reliability for the state water project. I did want to mention a number of other things though that you had discussed in your comment. And one of the big ones, it sounds like you're very concerned about flood effects near Twin Cities and traffic effects on Twin Cities. And so I just wanted to mention that we've heard that from a number of stakeholders, both of those concerns, particularly the flood impacts in and around Twin Cities. And we are planning to assess that within the environmental impact report, looking at the conditions that are there to understand if that could have the potential to make worse any of the conditions related to flood within that area. And we are also looking at the potential traffic effects by having the new traffic for construction workers, construction equipment coming in and out of Twin Cities. And if we do find effects there, we will be proposing mitigation for that associated with the environmental impact report.
And Carrie, the environmental impact report will be available for the public when?
In mid-2022. And as part of that also, I do know that there are a lot of different efforts going on and we will be looking at cumulative effects. So what happens if other reasonably foreseeable projects are implemented, would that make effects worse in a different direction? So we'll look at the cumulative effect of past, present, and future projects. So I just wanted to mention that that will be part of the environmental impact report analysis.
Thanks.
Great, and thank you.
Carrie,
can you also do a benefit cost on, as we go forward with the costs going up, to review the whole issue of desalination?
There's been lots of questions about desalination, and Carrie, maybe this is just a moment for you to address again what the Delta Conveyance Project is versus other ways that people can provide water in other places, other portfolios.
So because DWR is the owner and operator of the State Water Project, our purpose as part of this project is to allow the State Water Project to continue to function in the face of the many challenges that we know it will face and does face. So sort of leaving it as is to continue to degrade is not meeting our fundamental project purpose. So the idea that we would, instead of sort of improving the State Water Project, allow the State Water Project to degrade and have alternate supplies like desalination or recycling or conservation, that is not meeting our fundamental project purpose. However, it does describe the conditions that could occur if this project doesn't move forward. So if this project doesn't move forward, most likely the water agencies that receive water from the State Water Project would need to increase reliance on local supplies. And so what we're doing is we're assessing that within the no project alternative within the EIR, because that way we can compare the effects, the environmental effects of the different alternatives. We will be doing a cost benefit alternative later in the process, according to DWR's guidance. And so based on our internal protocols, we look at the proposed project, which we don't have yet, or the preferred alternative, which we haven't identified yet. So later in this process, when we've selected an alternative, we will be looking at a cost benefit before decisions are made.
Thanks, that's very helpful. Any other questions or suggestions from people in the public who want to talk about the potential leave behinds, the employment ideas, or any ideas for public engagement going forward?
Juliana, this is Graham. I just wanted to add real quickly before we got too far away from the comment. And I understand with iterations of the project and everything going on, the comment about it being, you know, challenging to keep up with everything. But I know we did a quick review of the project facilities, but I did want to highlight, since we were talking about Twin Cities, that there is no four-bay within Glanville Track. There are no new overpasses over I-5. Just to clarify that that's not part of any of the alternatives that are being evaluated.
Graham, maybe you could tell people, where's the best place for people to find the most recent information about the conveyance as it stands right now, the design?
Absolutely. So on the we have a website, the DCDCA, Delta Conveyance Design and Construction Authority. There are virtual tours for the entire project. And so they will essentially give you a flyby of the entire project from one end to the other. You can see where all the features are throughout on the landscape. You can see the details of the features, in some cases renders. So there's a lot of good information available there on the Delta Conveyance Design and Construction Authority website. Oh, I'm being handed another sticker. Facebook and YouTube also, Delta Conveyance Design and Construction Authority.
Hey Graham, that's dcdca.org.
DCDCA.org? Yes, correct.
Okay, so I want to give people a chance if there's any other questions or input. If not, then we'll end this meeting early. You can go to dinner. Oh, I'm seeing one person. There's a person named Rick. I'm sorry, I can't call you by your last name, but let me ask you to unmute yourself. Yes, Rick?
Yeah, good evening. I just wanted to make the point, and this might be so obvious that no one's made it, but the main leave behind needs to be that the Delta is a viable water-based agricultural and recreational region. That's the main leave behind in my mind. Bolden Island, to have a walk around Staten Island, or Venice Island, to have a ballpark. I mean, I'm not being negative about those things, but if this is not a viable agricultural and recreational region based around water, any other leave behind is going to be irrelevant.
Thanks. So anything that in terms of either the economic development ideas or the community benefits need to focus on the characteristics of the Delta as it is right now and needs to strengthen those, support those going forward.
Absolutely. And I don't discount the fact that these are going to be good paying jobs for a window of time if this thing ends up going through. But I think those are going to be people that are going to make a good wage and be living in Elk Grove or Sacramento. You know, the long lasting effects of those good wage paying jobs are not going to be that we're going to build a housing tract in Walnut Grove. The long-term effects of the region, I think it has to keep its character. That should be the leave behind. And I say that based on the gentleman from Twin Cities, that he needs to be able to farm when this stuff's all said and done. Thank you.
So thanks so much. So the information for the Community Benefits Fund, it may be that there's more economic development ideas in the Community Benefits Fund than these integrated benefits or economic development for the DCA. But we'll want to hear about those, and we'll just sort them into whichever the Community Benefits Fund or these integrated benefits when we put together the framework. So anybody else want to provide a comment or a program idea or a suggestion? I have a question from somebody who wants to know provide input on leave behind later. I wonder if I can ask you, Ryan, to go to the other slide deck and we'll go to the process next steps and how to provide information on how to provide input on other ideas, et cetera. So if you can go to the other slide deck. Great. So there's, so just to let you know where, what, what I've been doing is I've been summarizing each one of these meetings. I apologize that I haven't put the meeting report up from May 6th because there's way too many ideas, but I hope to have that done tomorrow or the next day. The next thing will be the draft community benefits program will be included as an appendix in the draft EIR, which is expected mid-2022. Meanwhile, the Department of Water Resources will be providing tools and resources to help further develop the community benefits program. If you want to provide any ideas on any of the either community benefits fund ideas or these economic development ideas, Ryan, if you can show the next slide, which provides the comment form or the project email. So if you see where it says the project email deltaconveyance@water.ca or the project guideline or the Delta Conveyance, if you those are ways to stay informed. If you send an email to the Community Benefits Fund, thank you. Right there, you'll see that information. So there's a form on the Department of Water Resources website, and you can go to that form and fill out any ideas that you have about the community benefits program. You can also send an email to that Delta Conveyance cbp@water.ca.gov, and we'll keep that open so we can keep getting your ideas about pools or places to support particular legacy communities or job training programs or whatever ideas you have. We'll keep collecting that information. The environmental impact report will be done the end of in the middle of June, then it goes off. In the meantime, we'll provide some resources for you all. Please let us know if there's any information that you want to send by email or on that community benefits form on the DWR website about ways to stay engaged, ways to provide information on how this program should be developed with your input going forward. We can't really develop this on our own. I need your input to know what the next steps are that make sense for you all. So I'm going to ask Carrie and Graham if they want to say the last words, and then we'll hope that you provide us some written input, and we will adjourn a little bit early so you can go have dinner or spend time with your families. Carrie, do you want to say last words?
I guess, Juliana, before we jump to last words, I did just want to see if we could ask for a moment if anyone had any comments or questions about process moving forward and engagement. We talked about that a little bit. You mentioned it during your presentation, but we didn't really have any comments or discussion on that afterwards.
Does anybody have any suggestions on how they want to be involved, next steps in developing the community engagement program?
I actually see that people might have left, so I'm not sure. I might have asked the question too late in the discussion.
Yeah. So that's all right. We will hope to hear from more of you. And please let us know if you have any ideas about how to stay engaged and how to provide information on the Community Benefits Fund. And Graham, did you want to have any last words before we leave for tonight?
I appreciate the opportunity to come and talk about the project. So look forward to speaking with everybody again.
Great. There's lots of ways to stay engaged and stay informed. So we hope to hear from you more soon, and you'll be able to track all this information on the DWR website. Thank you so much for all of your participation and your questions tonight, and have a good evening. Thank you so much.